There are three primary ways that you might react with people when your childhood trauma wounds get activated. Now, you've heard of fight, flight, freeze, and fawn as trauma reactions, but I'm talking about trauma reactions specifically around the relationship dynamic itself and the tendency that you might have under stress to cling to the other person, to try to control the other person, or to feel the urge to escape the other person. Okay, so that's how I see it. Cling, control, escape. And I'm really interested today in the escape reaction that so many of us with CPTSD struggle with sometimes, even if you're sometimes more prone to clinging, or sometimes you respond to threats by getting controlling. We all do a little of all of them, right? That feeling that you need to escape is very common, and it comes in a lot of sneaky forms. It's a kind of avoidance, and it can block your ability to form good relationships with partners or friends or anyone. And so I want to share a video here that's from my online course called Connection Bootcamp. It's all about healing isolation and the disconnection from other people that happens to so many people who were traumatized as kids. And in this video, I talk about the urge to flee. See what you think. If you've ever run away from a partner or a friend or a family member who loved you and cared about you, you know how painful this is, how intense the need is in the moment, and how bad it feels later. Maybe you got overwhelmed and triggered by intensity, or you got fearful about being so close to somebody, and you slipped into avoiding behaviors like disappearing on them, giving them the silent treatment, or damaging their trust, or lashing out at them so that they would leave, which is another form of you fleeing, actually. Even when we desperately want loving relationships in our lives, actually being close to people can be so triggering for traumatized people. It can feel impossible to endure that feeling without getting emotionally overwhelmed and needing to make impulsive decisions to leave or lash out. Okay, why do we do this? Everyone's different, but usually I'd say it's because of abandonment when we were young. There's something about neglect and abandonment that make a very strong imprint on us. You can heal it, but until you do, you'll probably have a strong pattern of seeking out people who abandon you, or if they don't, you abandon them. You might be more inclined toward one thing or the other. Most of us do a little bit of both, abandoning, getting abandoned before we're healed. But I want to say for the record, this should be a high healing priority. If you're hurting people with abandoning behavior, stopping this should be high on your list. Now, running out on people who are counting on you and throwing their lives into panic and uncertainty can be a form of emotional abuse. And if you're going to heal from what happened to you, you may have to look at the ways that you're acting out in the same way toward other people. This is one thing with some awareness and structure you can teach yourself to not do. You may not be able to stop other people from behaving this way, but you can stop your own abandoning behavior. And this can start to break the whole cycle, the imprinting of the abandonment that happened to you, and that problem of still attracting people who are going to abandon you. Now, when my CPTSD symptoms used to still be out of control, I was one of those people who clung to relationships, and then, trying to cope with that feeling of helplessness and dread, I'd run away. And in my mind, when I got really, really dysregulated and felt rejected, it would feel obvious and necessary that I have to get out of there. It was like gasping for air. Something would hurt my feelings, and I'd make a little speech, just very cut off from my emotions for that moment, and make a dramatic exit. And the thing is, the feeling would usually pass in a few minutes. Now, back then, I was mostly only in relationships that I really did want to get out of. They were not good. But I didn't have the nerve to leave properly. So sometimes the drama was what I needed, a big argument to get out the door. But it was a terrible pattern, and it always hurt people, and it hurt me. And if you're gonna have close relationships, hurtful behaviors have to stop. So fleeing dramatically has gone on the no-do list for me. I try not to do that. Now, I think a lot of people with CPTSD know that feeling, even when they're the clinging types like I was, because sometimes clinging balances itself out by running the heck away. Pete Walker, who wrote the book CPTSD, From Surviving to Thriving, I often mention this book, it's a good one. You can buy it online, Pete Walker. His book describes the four trauma responses as fight, flight, freeze, and fawn. And when you run away from someone, that's flight. So flight or fleeing, it's not the same as a boundary, and it's not the same as a healthy separation from something that you need to step back from. Fleeing is a destructive impulse. It's like crack. Not that I've ever done crack, but when that CPTSD feeling is bearing down on you, fleeing, it just feels fantastic in that moment for a minute, and then it feels terrible. And of course, healthy people aren't into people who flee. You know who puts up with it? Other people who are traumatized, other people with abandonment issues, other people who are likely to abandon you. They're like, you ran out of me and came back? I think I'm in love, right? That's one reason why our lives are so heavily populated with other traumatized people. Yes, they understand, but also when they're not healed, they'll put up with your worst behaviors. They're still around when you're acting that way, and other people have gone. And then we stand there and look at who's left and say, why is everyone in my life so majorly screwed up? And it's not a mystery. We can put up with each other. But since you're working on developing healthier connections, it's important to remember that healthy people consider fleeing behavior a big red flag, a big NO when someone just runs out and abandons them. Now remember, you can still leave if that's really what's best. And if you've been living with CPTSD a long time, there are probably going to be a few characters who don't belong in your life now that you're healing. But ending relationships is best done soberly, carefully, considerately, and not when you're frantic or buried in dysregulated trauma thinking. So here's what you can do to soften that urge to flee. Now remember, the triggers for this fleeing frame of mind are very sneaky. Someone hurts you and you just whoosh, you just slip very silently into that frame of mind. So first, the work that you began the other day to become more aware of your people triggers is going to help you tremendously. With awareness, you can begin to notice when you're triggered, when you're slipping into it, and your thinking is getting distorted. Your emotions start to get oversized in those circumstances because under stress, that's what we do. That's what happens to people traumatized as kids. Your reasoning is pushed down, your emotions go up, way out of balance. Things feel terrible. They feel urgent. Old messages about being worthless and unwanted beg you to do something, say something, stop it at the source, and you think the source is the person in front of you, that if you leave, you can turn off the spigot of those emotions. Maybe you can, but usually not. Now, before you had any awareness, that urge to flee would come up and you didn't even know what hit you. It felt like a very reasonable thing to do, to just walk out or storm out in a blaze of self-righteousness and anger, right? In the moment, that can feel like it's going to solve the horrible feeling that you're trying to keep from grabbing onto you. It feels like that feeling is being caused by the other person, but actually, it's your CPTSD talking. Now, as always, I'm not talking about situations where you're getting abused. If you're in danger, get yourself and any kids out of there to safety, and don't stop to analyze or do it perfectly. You can do all of that later. But when it's you hurting someone who you want in your life, then you know too well that feeling that comes after you leave, the emptiness and the remorse and shame and panic when you're sitting in your car, you know, an hour away from home, knowing, oh, I did it again. I made someone feel abandoned, or I said things I didn't mean. It's not your fault that you have CPTSD or that you get dysregulated and triggered around people. It's probably hurt you more than anyone. But when this behavior comes up, you know it's got to change. When it happens, it could be an hour, it could be a day or a week before you can feel again, before you can see more clearly that your thinking was distorted. You lost your sensitivity and perception when you got triggered. And don't think that the only alternative to lashing out is like self-suppression. Oh, I'll just be quiet next time, I won't say a word. I'm sure you've tried that, and you know from experience that doesn't work either. There are three things that allowed me to change this behavior. The one I mentioned already is that you have to learn to notice those triggers when they pop up. When you can notice that your triggers are getting set off, you can stop them. How will you know? They give you signs. For me, my nose gets numb. I get clumsy. I get a sense that I have to do something about what's bothering me this second. Never a good sign. Nothing I should actually act on. It means delay. Or I start having this yucky thought. I don't need you. I don't need anybody. So I know myself now, and I know that when those signs are showing up, that thinking, I'm triggered. And no matter what I think I should do, I will override that thought and just stop talking before I say something hurtful. I don't want to do that anymore. I want things to get better. So I refrain from saying my thoughts and instead do the second thing, which is to discharge those negative thoughts safely so that I can calm the triggers and gain some perspective. Now, how do you do that? It's through the daily practice you learned the other day. The shift is sometimes dramatic, but usually very subtle. You might be surprised how helpful it is. If you've been using the daily practice the last few days, you may have noticed a little change, a little distance between a strong emotion and what you do or say about it. Learning to pause there can change your life. Now, sometimes writing will bring about tears or a big feeling of relief. Don't worry too much what happens. It'll mostly feel like no big deal, most days. Just let it do its work on your stressed out mind. Now, the writing and meditation go hand in hand. You face the thoughts bothering you and write them down. And then after you ask for them to be removed, you rest your mind in meditation. And again, just let the techniques gently do the work of calming your triggers and lightening your mind. Not blissed out necessarily, just lucid. And I talk about these techniques in every course I create, but they're crucial in this course because calming your triggers enables connection, and connection enables you to calm your triggers. It's like both ways. Connection can be hard, but it can also provide the love and feedback that you need to keep going in a positive direction. And that's what friends do for each other. That's the third thing. You've got to be connected to somebody and talking to them about what you're doing. The best person would be somebody who's also doing this. You might be able to find that in my membership community or coming to the free daily practice calls. You might be able to introduce somebody to the techniques, but you're going to need somebody to connect. So those are the three things. Now, yes, connecting carries the risk that it'll be too much, too fast, and it'll trigger the urge to flee again. That is a risk, but it's something you can learn to handle and even to prevent by going slowly, little change at a time. And finally, you can handle the tough moments without destroying the whole thing. You can communicate, you can consider things, you can make requests. These are all things that lead to clarity, and they allow you choices about pulling away or getting closer to people. Closeness is possible if you can learn to properly handle the intense urge to flee when it comes up.